are talking about the course itself, some really short points about the history, aims in statistics, but that is really a general introduction, of course, only to let you know that you are not the first person in life who has to suffer from bias statistics. But of course, I think that's also important. And then the next part will be particular multiple linear regression models, the application and effect estimation prediction. And I believe particularly the persons participating in the bridging course will know some of it, of course not all of it, and therefore it is part of the repetition, and there are also some new parts in, and therefore I go through very fast, but please ask. That's really very important. Okay. That are now the topics. And of course now, today, we are talking about, and I'm always talking about the regression model, because that overall course is calling applied biostatistics. That means you have to learn how to use data. And of course, we expect that all of you know how to do a simple statistic like mean, standard deviation, a chi-square test, something like that you have learned before, because it is applied biostatistics. If not, because sometimes you haven't learned it, or sometimes you haven't seen it, or sometimes you have forgot it, please look in the old books, because probably you have some books. And, or if you get really problems, then come to my office and we can find a solution how you can get this information that is missing. Okay, linear regression we are talking today. Next week there will be logistic regression. Logistic regression, I believe, also all of you have heard in beforehand. But we will also talk here about, even though the topic is called logistic regression, we will also talk about nominal logistic regression. That means an outcome more than only a binary outcome. Then there is really a more or less new lecture in about Poisson and multi-level regression, in particular the Poisson regression that was done last year as well. But multi-level, as it is really something that is growing importance in the biostatistic, and it is used a lot in the scientific area, I think it is important to introduce it. When I did the exercises, I recognized, it is difficult. But of course, also, I believe it is nice to see that statistic does not mean I put all the variables, put enter, and say, okay, the model is ready. Because particularly in multi-level modeling, you really have to look a lot of things. And I think, therefore, it is really nice to do that exercises. And of course, we will do it together. And also, the problem now is that the instructors, as they did the course last year, and I'm always begging all older students to do the exercise or the instructor work. And normally that's fine because they know exactly which problem they had last year. But of course in this particular point, it might be that they have the same problems that you. Of course we will deal with all that, or I will be there as well. We have to solve that problem. In the same week, that means in week number 49, there will be an additional lecture about analysis time to event. We could also say Cox regression, to choose always the word regression in the line. Also multi-level should be named multi-level regression, or Poisson regression is also a regression. Therefore we are always talking about regression.
In our overall schedule it says that it is in week 1-8. And then on Friday.
Yes. That is totally wrong. No. But there was an old version available.
Not a Friday, but the Tuesday we have ethics.
Yes, no, not ethics. I think there is. It is only for one day. And I've checked with Jana that we don't have any lectures at that time. And it is in the morning. It is between 9 to 12 o'clock. And I have talked to Lulu, because she has, at the later time, ethics. And you will have from 9. Please, can you listen, because I'm explaining it to you. You will have on 9, unfortunately it starts then at 9 o'clock. That's not very fine for you, but unfortunately we couldn't find another place. From 9 to 12, the lecture in biostatistics, and after 12, not Lulu, Maya is doing the ITIC. After 12, Maya starts for the next 3 hours with ITIC. And that is fixed with her. And therefore, I believe you don't get problems with that, or I hope so. Otherwise, please let me know. Because we have the problem to do it always with two lectures, and I really suggest also the Cox regression. We invite a person, a biostatistic person from Germany, and he will do the lectures about Cox regression, Poisson, and multi-level regression, and of course he's doing it totally different to me. But I think particularly this is nice, because then you don't get, not only get my pictures and strange explanation, you get also the more biostatistic part of it, with formulas and derivation, how you can get it. And I think you should know both of it. In particular, the part of multi-level analysis, even though we are working together, I'm developing the exercises, he's doing the courses, he's doing the lecture time. I think it is also nice to have him with, because as biostatistician, he knows a bit better how to deal with such a complex material. But therefore, because he cannot come twice every week, we decided to have two lectures in 1 week. And then, of course, in the next week, we don't have any lecture in biostatistics. And that is also not scheduled in the overall timetable, because I think that's easy for you to drop them and to take them. Okay, yes.
So if we don't have any lectures, do we still have the exercises in
exactly.
the week 50?
The exercises, because otherwise he would have had two exercises in week 49, and that's really too difficult.
Yeah.
And therefore we decided to have the exercises in week 50, but we don't have the lectures on Monday.
Okay.
But the exercises will take place. Because that is really always the exercises are named afterwards, but here of course it's then a week later. Then study analysis, you get some. Also some data documentation we put there in now, meta-analysis as the very last end. And then the last week, the topic is here, looking in further statistical method. Of course, I won't do it, because formerly I presented their multi-level analysis, but now we put it more at the top. I think that will then be used to do some repeatings and preparing for the exams. I think that is more important for you. For the last week. Okay, Stata. Who knows Stata? Oh no, it's easier to ask who didn't know. Who did do not know Stata? That's not a lot. It's an easy program. I think that's really, but you know, all of you have no knowledge about some specific statistical programs, or are there some persons who didn't know? Okay, no, that's fine that you're saying that. And of course, that's really also, particularly the first exercises might be a bit hard for you. Keep doing further and always ask. And here I really like to beg to all the colleagues, please at first try to help her as well, because you know exactly how difficult it is to start with such a strange program. Of course, it is not really difficult, but at the beginning you believe it's crazy. And therefore, please help each other. And otherwise, if you really don't get started, fine, come to my office or really talk to the instructors. I think that is the topic for them to deal with all the problems. And don't believe, stop doing it because it's too difficult. It isn't. It is really not too difficult. Okay. The statistical program is simple because you have here you have to work and all the rest is for nothing. That means you don't have a lot to do. That's not. Of course, that's a picture from the old program. They're always changing. And nowadays, I think this line is on the other side. But of course, it looks more or less similar. And here you have where it's written the title comment. You see all the comments you have done in beforehand. If you say to the program, for example, now calculate the mean. If you write it in specific words, it's really also a kind of language. And then he's calculating the mean. And of course, then you need also the names of the variables, and really you have to choose that variable for where you like to have the mean, and that you write down under here. And then the results of that, what you did, is appearing in this big screen in the middle. But of course, you can do it step by step while having the exercises. Okay. I love this Kirkbook book because I hope every person or a lot of persons know to have it. Otherwise, I can really recommend buy it. That is, excuse me, only shortly. It is really a very good one. And it has two, well, that's my opinion. Of course, sometimes persons have different opinions. And it is short. It explains in a very specific, exemplary manner. And it contains a lot. Some other books, like for example, oh, that's not here. There are some other books available where you have a lot more in information. But of course, to say the truth, probably I believe, because you will not work as biostatistician in future, and therefore you don't need such a huge amount of information. And the Kirkwood is really giving more or less the best overview about everything. There are also some other books available, particularly in the part about nominal logistic regression, because that is really introduced in the Kirkwood book really in one chapter, and that's too less. And therefore now we added also some additional book chapters, but these will be available always via Blackboard. In that specific part you will see a part of a book chapter as PDF, and that is because it is a part where the lecture is based on. And that is also written in that, I think in the overall part in the Blackboard, you find this one. Of course, at the moment I recognize it is not the actual version because we are still working on it and I'm still waiting for the last book recommendation from Mario. But if they are there, therefore please don't print it out now. Wait still 1 week, I hope then everything is ready. And then I will upload the newest version and then I will send an email also around that you know, okay, there are the newest book recommendation available. Okay, internet links. That is particular if you look in Stata, in particular if you don't remember what was the recommend to do calculate a mean. It is so easy to Google it in the internet. It is easier to Google it in the internet than to look in the help of Stata itself. It takes more time, I recognize, because I've worked a lot now in that area. And at the end, I decided only to Google it because then you can get also a lot of explanation how to use it and what is easier. And therefore, I can really recommend to use, if you are not really trust what to do and what to use after a comma or before a comma, then Google this command step and always put Stata in behind, and then you will get the right information. But of course, there are also some other links available. And of course, you can go through. I don't need to explain them carefully. But if you have some good links, because that is always, you're not, you only know such a long or such a lot of things if they are really there. That means if you find something really where you believe, oh, that is really good, and there it's explained very nicely, send it to me, because then I can add it also in the literature, and that helps also your future generation in understanding a bit easier biostatistics, even though it's easy to understand. That's also an awful topic. Of course, I could easily explain. All persons are really more than all persons. A lot of persons have fear about the biostatistics exam. Why? Simple. And of course, no, I think it is really simple. If you really participate all the courses, and if you really participate the exercises, I think the exercises, of course, I like to have you here, but and I think it's also nice that you are here, but the exercises are more important than the lectures, because then you can do, you try to interpret, and if you don't get it interpreted, you can ask the instructors. And I believe today we have really good instructors. I can really convince you. They're really very nice, and they know a lot. And therefore, I think that is really very important if you prepare all the exercises, and it's a huge amount of work. I really know, probably all the person who participate the bridging course know that you have time 3 hours, but you could work sometimes 12 hours, not that, but more than this 3 hours. And I can really convince you to do it, even though it takes more time. There are some persons really who don't need more than 3 hours. I don't know how, probably it would not be me as well, but it is calculated that you have more, that you need more time to do all the exercises. And the exercises are also built up in that direction that you really learn step by step the next time. Therefore, you have to do all the exercises and go through it and not only say, oh, I'm doing the first two exercises from linear regression and then it's boring enough. And then, of course, I start once again with Fox regression because logistic regression is boring as well. Please don't do that. That is really very dangerous. You have to do step by step. And I know it's a huge amount of work, but it's only 8 weeks and Christmas time is in between. And we will solve this without any problem. Okay. And then the exam at the end is 3 hours. And it will really be more or less the same exercises as you do in the exercises. Of course, you can't use the data because you only get the output and you need to interpret the output. That is part of the exercise. There will also be some stata document comment lines where you have to interpret what is written or what is mistake is written in this comment line. Of course, it sounds a bit crazy, but you can use whatever material you like to have. And therefore, I would also suggest in beforehand really all comment lines you learn, make something like a list and write in behind what it is. That's really simple when you're doing it from the beginning. Yes?
You just
said that you couldn't use stats in the exam. You don't have, you have access to computer, but I decided not to use Stata by your own because that's really awful. There are a lot of persons who need really double so long time to put a comment line in, and I believe that's not fair to use data in, during the exam. Because it is only a 3 hour exam, and therefore you only get the output. You don't need to use Stata in the exam. Of course, there is one problem. Well, of course, if I look around, all of you have a computer. But do you all have access to your own laptop? And I think that's really important because I totally forgot to upload how to install Stata on your laptop because all of you need to use your own computer and Stata is accessible via internet and or via the Blackboard, and there you can find also in Blackboard as the overall explanation from the course somehow some explanation how to install Stata on your computer. All the person from the bridging course, I believe they have it, and you can use the same, of course, don't install it once again. It is only for that person who probably don't have used Stata before and who don't have installed it up to now. Okay, but unfortunately, there is something else that is important to do before starting the exam. And that is really to, and therefore it is also a part to learn statistical, to go to work with the statistical program Stata, that you get a data set and you get some questions to the data set and you have to solve or to answer that research question. And that of course you should do in groups of about 5 persons and to submit to me and to Blackboard as well, and then this is an obligatory task. If you don't do it, of course, you are not allowed to write the exam. Therefore, the exam contains 2 parts. At first, this exercise, and then the 3 hour exam. Of course, the character or the grade is only calculated by the exam, because for a character, you need to have individual work. And therefore, this is overall really a kind of past and not past. And of course, that is really also really, I can say to you, if you submit an empty paper, you won't pass. And if you submit a one-page paper where you write, Gabriele is bad, you won't pass either. But if you really do your exercises, even though there are mistakes, and it must not be correct, I only need to recognize that you try to do your job. And then, of course, you get also feedback from me. I think that is the more important part, really, to get feedback and to say, that was a good idea, that was bad. Here you can do probably that and that. And in this way, it is only that you should show that you try to answer the research question. And if you try to answer it, that's okay. Doesn't matter if it is correct or not. Of course, I hope and I believe all of this, all of the answers will be correct. But I think for me, it is only important that I recognize that you try to answer, or that you try the best to answer.
When are we going to get an introduction to this exam, and when are we going to hand it in?
Perfect. I still haven't organized that. Therefore, last year it was available in the middle of December. December, and to submit it should be, well, we decided last year to let you submit at the beginning of the next year, because then you have time for Christmas time, but of course I always suggest do it in beforehand. You have enough time to do it in beforehand, and then of course you can also come and ask questions to the instructors, because they won't be there through Christmas time. But that was really backed by the last year's students, that they have time for Christmas time, even though I think most of them submitted it before Christmas, because that's always nicer, because then it's...
But it's not possible to get the introduction even before the
mid-term. You will get the introduction as soon as possible, but at the moment I don't have the data set. Well, I have to prepare it in beforehand. And at the moment I'm still working with the multi-level introduction or lecture or exercises, and if that is done, I will develop this one, and then you get it. I think you get it as soon as possible. Yes.
Can we choose by ourselves the groups?
Very good question. Yes, you can choose by yourself. I would like to suggest to do it inside the groups where you are sitting in the biostatistic course, because then you can also work together in that part if you have time and enjoy, but that's not necessary. It's your choice. You can choose whatever you want. And of course, that's really also use it like a kind of group working together to prepare the exams. I think that is your choice.
You said groups of about five?
About five.
Okay, so
that means if you are six, I would say that's okay. If you are three, I would say, oh, that's... But of course, if there's also an explanation that there are only three persons living in Copenhagen, I would say, okay, that's totally okay if you're only three, if there's really a reason why you choose to be three. Otherwise, try to keep five, because that's really, or not keep something like 10, because that really means that only three are working and the rest is doing nothing. Okay. Yes?
Do you know the date of the written examination? Or do you just know that it's in week four or five?
I think it is in week four or five, but I don't know exactly the exam. No.
Okay. It will be on Blackboard this week.
Oh, perfect. Yeah. Because I know some has asked Janne, and then she's organizing it, but
yeah.
She hasn't
told
organized
me that it
would
be available to see that in this week.
Perfect. That's really fine. Okay. Another question with regard to the course. Then we are going now to this history. And of course I like that, because I'm coming from Germany and therefore Gottfried Achenwald, it's really a very German name. And he was really the developer of the word statistics firstly in 1750. And that was really, in his meaning, it was the science of the state. It has to do something with science and not with number. But of course, that is really the nice way. But of course, it was more or less introduced in English a bit later. in 1790 by Sir John Sinclair, when he published the first 21 volumes titled Statistical Account from Scotland, and that's really also a part of really first introduction in epidemiology, because he likes really to bring the number of deaths in between between different diseases and outcomes, and that was the first time presented then. And that was really early, because they didn't have any computer, and it was possible for them really to count all the numbers, and later on it was also checked that it was quite good counting. That's really crazy. Okay, probably, of course, I like to introduce only some more important names, and of course that is a collection, that is my collection. Please don't believe that are the most important in the world. I collected, for example, a German person, of course I had to do because I'm from Germany, and a bit curious, I had also a statistician professor called Gauss, and therefore I like him. It was not the same, of course not, because he was but he was written in the same way, and he always introduced Gauss, and therefore I had to introduce him as well. But I think probably you have known something about the Gauss distribution. I think that was really he developed it. John Grant, I think that is really one of the most important old persons doing first descriptive statistics. Thomas Bayes, probability, do you remember the Bayes theorem that was developed by him in 18th century? Of course, then I also choose a Danish person. I think that's also nice, because there are also, but of course now I have to check, because I don't like to say something wrong, but he was really the developer of the likelihood. And of course, probably you don't remember exactly, but in a logistic regression model, there was something like log likelihood ratio. And of course, that part of the likelihood in the log likelihood ratio of logistic regression was developed by Torvald Thiele. And therefore, that's really very crazy that you find a lot of specific small parts developed by a lot of persons. And then, of course, you see also Florence Nightingale. I think everybody knows here, because she is really one of the most public health persons. Probably you're a bit surprised, but she did also statistics in a very descriptive manner, because she was always interested in describing how health is presented and how important it is. And therefore, she is also named a lot in biostatistics because of her descriptive kind of autographs she developed, or how to bring, or how to present numbers. Of course, I choose her also because I tried to choose a woman. That was really difficult, because they are all male, and it's really difficult to find a female one. Even though nowadays there are a lot of biostatistics, female biostatisticians available, but in the history that was really more or less purely male research. Pearson, I think I don't need to introduce him. Pearson, correlation coefficient, we will talk about him also a lot. Ronald Fisher. Fisher, you have heard? Exactly. Yeah. Fisher exact test, he also developed part of the t-test. Of course, t-test was Carl Pearson, but the exact test in t-test, that was Fisher. Therefore, also you recognize they are sometimes working together. Of course, they also live together in England, and they know each other as well. But of course, sometimes they also develop different parts. And of course, I also like to know some living biostatistician. That is David Cox, and of course, that's also easy what he developed, Cox regression, that you have to learn also as well. That's really a tricky part, but of course, if you understand it, it's easy as well. And Bradley is a newer person, he's also alive, Bradley Efron from America. You will also hear something, but of course, probably you don't know it up to now. He developed something that is really new. I think it was developed last 10 or 20 years. That is a so-called bootstrap method. It's a kind of calculating confidence interval or a p statistic insurity, and therefore I think yes, we still have it as a model 3. I'm talking about it that as well, and then I will hopefully remember to name him once again. Okay, yes, that I don't need, I always start with that, but now I have to hear it as well. Why biostatistics is important? Because I always have to say it is a kind of adventure. It is a kind of crime. It is a kind of a surprising result. I can really also, nowadays I have less time to do really statistical analysis on my own. Unfortunately, but it is so curious and it's so nice and really to develop the research question, to think about what you're interesting to know and then to count the numbers and then to recognize, oh, that's totally vice versa. You did something wrong or even not, but the result is as it is, and then you need to find the explanation why the result is as it is. It is really a crime and it's really very, very nice. I can really also or I hope I can increase a bit the curiosity in you to do it by your own as well. Because that is really something, at the end, of course, in the beginning, when you see all the missings in the data set, all the problems, and then the model is not working, and the model fit, and you will really recognize, oh, there's so bad things in between. But at the end, it's so fine if you get the result, and if you then, at the final end, see the result published in a paper, it's really a nice feeling, and therefore I hope that you can find it as well. Therefore, of course you need to know it, and of course you need to know it by doing yourself, and that is the aim of our exercise here. But if you believe, oh no, I hate numbers, and I will never do statistical analysis, unfortunately I have to say to you, unlucky you, you need it as well. Because you need to understand scientific articles, and without no knowledge about it, you will get really problems. And please remember, 90% of all scientific articles are quantitative. And in all these 90%, you need that, what you learned here. That means if you like to read articles, you, unfortunately, I have to say, you have to do this as well. Of course, that's really not fine, because if you're not liking doing it, I think that's really also a difficult part. But that's really very important for all the parts you need to do. Okay, that was now the introduction. And I still like to start with linear regression. I said I have a lot of slides, therefore I have to hurry a bit, excuse me. The next person, Galton, Francis Galton, that's British scientist, excuse me, and also author. That is really also nice if you look in the history of biostatistician. They were philosophy men, they were medical men, they were, I think Pearson was the only person who studied mathematics, and then really biostatistics, or that was his own area, but all the other former scientists, they were everything. And beside this, also a statistician. That's really crazy. And Francis Galton has really developed the linear regression, and that is really a very old idea, what he likes to show, that if the parents, of course that is not available nowadays, because nowadays children are always taller. Taller than the parents, but formerly they were always more or less the same. And then he recognized by comparing the partners or the parents and the children that there was something like a regression to the mean. If the parents was in this, the children were more or less always a bit beneath or beside them. It was not really the same variation as around all children. If the parents were smaller, the children were always smaller as well. If the parents were taller, the children were also taller, and that is called like the regression to the mean. That means it's always getting to the same, more similar design. And in this way, he produced the first type of regression analysis. Now some examples. That's only to get some idea what does that mean. I think you always know, all the persons know, that in regression analysis you have a Y, you have something like Y, and an X, and something like a beta null, and here you have something like beta 1, where you estimate for the X is calculated. And in this way, you can also put something like a line here in between. You can really draw a line, and here, if you would try to draw a line only by your own, without having a computer, of course, I believe all of us would start here, and would end over there at the top. That means you would always have an increasing line, starting from the bottom and going to the top. And in this way, it's a bit more difficult. But of course, you could do it as well. And here it is shown the age versus weight. And then it's children, and of course in children, the age is always positive associated with the weight, because here we have 6 years old children, and here we have 12 years of children, and they are normally more than double so heavy than the younger ones. And here we have the height and the weight, and then you recognize that height and weight probably is not so clearly associated, even though you can draw also a line as well, but it is not really very clear. Okay. And now we will see more or less the results from the regression analysis, and all the person with it, the bridging course, of course, might see that this is really the program, the command line. I always try to put it in red, but you see what you have to write in Stata in the command line. That means here you have to put at least and then choose the so-called dependent variable and then the two independent variables,
you know,
this which can its weight. And here, of course, it is highly significant because it's 0.001.
That is really only to go back here.
Okay,
here you have Y,
because
that's both lines.
H, I can explain fairly good H.
Weight, and here you have H at high as X as independent.
And just R squared means at the moment, because this region here, if you have all the ones here, you have one, you have to interpret always only R square, the adjusted R square, that means the second row. And here you have 0.73.
What does that mean?
R square, what's that? Oh, of course, you should know. It explains the variation of your data set. That means you could say with height and age, you can explain 73% of the variation of weight. That's really good.
Yeah, it's just maybe a silly question, but R squared, adjusted R squared can maximum be 1.
Right? Okay. It's not a silly question, very good question. R squared can at minimum be 0, because you can't explain less than 0. And then, of course, there is really one big disadvantage in statistics, even though from the logical point of view it can't be less than 0. From the calculatory point of view, I have also had some linear regression models where the adjusted R squared was negative. The only thing, please don't interpret that the variance is less than explained. The only explanation is, and probably then, of course, the probability of the F-test won't be significant anymore, because then it is a, to say, a shit model, and if you put shit in, you get shit out, and then, of course, there's also coming out really something like a negative R-square, but in case not, can't be possible.
But therefore, normally you can expect an R square between 0, that would be a very bad R square, or 1, or 0.99, that would be a really good R square. Do you have a question?
What would be the difference between R square and just R square?
Perfect question. The R square is the unique one that was developed. Of course, I think in the bridging course I showed also the formula how to calculate it. Very simple because it's connected to the correlation coefficient, to the Pearson correlation coefficient. Now there is a problem if you do a multiple model, because in a multiple model you put always more variables in. And the problem in the normal unadjusted R square, the crude one, the R square is, doesn't matter if you put a crazy variable in or not, the R square will always be better. But sometimes if you put a very bad variable in, it might be worse. And therefore, a very nice statistician, I don't know his name, but it, probably it was a man, developed the so-called adjusted R-square that adjusts for the effect that you have more than one variable in the model. And therefore, that is now the rule. If you have the simple model, only one depending variable and one independent variable, then you should use the normal R-square, because that is totally fine. But if you have, like here, two variables or even more, doesn't matter, then you should always only use the adjusted R-square. Because there it is adjusted for you have more variables in the model. Yes?
What did you say about the R-square? You said that it explains 73% of
the variation of the depending of the weight.
Okay.
The depending variable.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Because, well, let us go back to the picture. Oh, once again, the wrong direction. Here you have in the weight the variation from 50 to 80. And of course, 70% doesn't mean 70% of this, but the variation would be smaller when you consider all these variables in there. You can explain a lot about this.
Is it a good number?
73% is very good.
Okay.
That's really, and of course, that's really something very difficult to say what is acceptable or what is not acceptable, because that's really depending to the research question. I know, for example, in nutrition, although I'm not a nutritionist, and in nutritional epidemiology, we sometimes only get something like 5% or 10%, and we are glad about that. And of course, in psychology, for example, you get something like 70 or 80%, and they are really unhappy about something like 0.5 or 50%. Therefore, that's really depending to the research question you are in. And therefore, you can't say something general. Of course, general you can say as higher, as better. That's really simple. Okay, I think that is now also a very small repetition. I think we should have a break, is that right? Mm-hmm. 5 minutes break? And a body weight of 75. That will have maybe a price question. You do a research question
and then you understand that.
Two points.
You have the true y, and this case would be 75.
So the regression line that is marked in
true
red
weight
here.
The person.
The regression line is based on this.
And then you have
the
head
weight
that you get
would be y.
You expect
and the body
estimate
would be
the weight
x. Of course, then you don't have this one.
Or the linear regression.
Okay,
and
then of
course
you have something that is missing. Because of course it would be perfect if you get both on the same, but that O'Brien given, because with the line you always have some variation. And then you get something like E, or that is called random error, and that is called residual. And that are the residuals. And then of course you can understand, as smaller the residuals, as better the model is. But the residuals, no, as smaller, that's not true. Well, as as nearer by zero. That is the correct way, because let us look at this other part. Here, of course, you have the same. You have the true y, because that person has a height, a body length from 185, and the weight is 78. Oh, is that possible? That's really very, it's a very lean person. Doesn't matter. But of course, here you can see the y hat. That means that what you estimate via the linear regression model is higher. And that means the error can be negative as well. That means the standard error, or excuse me, the random error can be positive, because then you know that the your estimation will underestimate reality, but it can also be negative. That means your estimation overestimate reality.
Can you say that again?
Of course, the red line is your estimation you get from the formula.
Mm.
Of course, and the random error is positive if you underestimate with your given regression line the true value, because your estimation is below the true value, then you have a positive random error. But of course, you can also underestimate. That means you overestimate. That means your regression line estimates a weight that is higher than the reality, and then the random error is lower.
So the random error is the same as residual.
Perfect. Yes. Perfect. Random error is also called residuals, and therefore also that is really the part that you say, for example, the residuals should be normal distributed, and all the tests you will do later on in the next week are always connected to residuals, because they explaining a lot how great your model is. Okay, of course not totally without formulas, but that is the same I have had here. It's totally the same, but you have something else that is called set 3 and set 4. That makes it a bit more difficult. Of course, you have the simple variation, or the simple linear regression you have is here to have y is weight and h, both variables are numerical. What happens if you don't have a numerical value? If you have, for example, sex. Of course, you can code it numerical as well. Well, you can decide if null is man or null is women. But of course, you can use a code, a binary code. And normally, it should always be 1 and 0, or sometimes it can also be 2 and 1 and 2, doesn't matter, but you have something like a binary code. And in this way, that's totally simple, because you can have it as in the same way in the model, and the computer is only calculating null is the reference, one is the exposure, and then you can easily interpret it. If you say one is female, if you are female, you have 1.5, because then you can interpret the story a little bit better, and beforehand 1.5 increased higher weight or lower weight, doesn't matter what is the result. That is very simple to code a binary outcome in a linear regression. And now you see here something like set 3, set 4. That is something where you have more than a binary outcome, because, for example, you have BMI, normal weight, overweight, and obese. We are doing something here in Denmark, therefore underweight is not important, excuse me. They are always put together to normal weight.
but to distribute overweight in the bees. If we do something in Ghana or other countries, probably we should delete obese and put underweight, normal weight, overweight. Therefore, we have different categories in different countries. But here we are talking now about normal, overweight, and obese. How can you code it? For example, 1, 2, 3. It is possible to use in a linear regression as well. But in this way, you have to use two different variables. I would say, call it BMI over and BMI obese. And then you have something like a so-called dummy variables. And the dummy variables are so-called, of course, we put it now in another color. Is that here available? Yes. If you like to code so-called dummy variables, because in linear regression models can only work with 0 and 1, but not with 2 and 3. That means we need to recode this variable that we have binary codes. How can we do? We have here one obese. Obese should be 1 if they are obese. Therefore, it's called BMI obese. And the rest is coded 0. Then you have your dummy variable for obese person. The second for the overweight dummy, you have 1 if the persons are overweight. And of course, if they are normal weight or obese, you have 0. That means you have now the three categories coded in two variables, always with 1 and 0. And here, of course, you have the normal weight, and that would be 1 if the normal weight is in, and the rest is 0. That means in this way, you could code a BMI, that is three categories, and three single variables where they are only 1 coded. And now it's very tricky, because that is even nice if you code it like this way, because you need to choose one of these as reference group. And of course, as reference group, I always like to choose normal weight, because normal weight explains the normal person, and that would be the reference group. And therefore, it is called yellow, or it's written in yellow, because it is not necessary to consider in the model. And therefore, you would have here to consider BMI in the model. You would have one variable called BMI over, which is this one, or you would one have, which is called obese, which is this one. And then, as we said here in the sex, if you are female, you have a so-called increase in. You can say here also, if you are overweight, your increase is so much higher compared to normal weight. If you are obese, your increase is so much higher compared to normal weight. That is a nice way. And that in the slide is called with set 3 and set 4. That is meant that you can also use categorical variables in a linear regression model. And that is really very important. You have to use it several times. And therefore, please, you should. And of course, the coding, even though I'm doing the coding always by myself, because I like to know what I'm doing, I like to understand what I'm doing, but of course data is doing it for you. You only need to put something like an E in before the variable, and then it is coded like this. And then you can see also that the codes are really created, and you can check if they are created only with 0 and 1, but of course it is like that. Okay. Now we have one example, looking on serum cholesterol, and of course it's not a
example in Denmark, it was a temple in Germany, but it was for an exam.
Therefore, I have used the word Denmark to make it more. But it was a very old survey in Germany. It was done in 1987. Therefore, I believe I could use this data set also here for teaching purposes. And here, the research question was, is intake of pure alcohol consumption associated with HDL cholesterol? Who knows something about HDL cholesterol? Cholesterol is, yes? Perfect. Is it healthy or is it unhealthy?
You cannot take that because there are two subparts of it, big and small. So it was supposed to be healthy, but...
But nowadays it's different. Okay. Yes, that you recognize. It's really a very tricky part, talking about cholesterol, yes and no. But here we are now only, it's only a joke, only to look at HDL cholesterol, and of course, it is known that alcohol consumption is associated with HDL cholesterol, and therefore we like to know if that is reality or why it is there. And here you see also, do you remember the first part where you have only these 12 points? Then it's easier to interpret a scatter plot. Of course, here we have, I think, 1,900 and some something plots, points, and of course then it is really difficult to see something. But would you say here you have alcohol consumption, the variable is called NS, the nutritional intake of alcohol. Oh, that's German. Well, doesn't matter, I don't need. And here's the blood cholesterol, the blood measurements or serum concentration of HDL cholesterol. And here you see the BMI in connection to HDL cholesterol. What would you suggest? Is there an association or not? Well, of course, that is really also very important in the exam. Doesn't matter what you say, everything is correct. Because you can't see anything. It's not really clearly given a line. Because if there is clearly a line and you say, no, there is no association, then it will be really estimated wrong. But here, what can you see? Of course, you can probably see here something increasing. And you can probably also see there is something decreasing. But of course, here you could, I don't know, it can be wrong. You don't know exactly. And if you can explain it, what you're seeing. And you can also say, okay, I see here something like it is always decreasing, and therefore I'm seeing something decreasing. I think that's totally okay. It is important to understand that you see what you see. Okay, but let us then look in the linear regression model. Here you can see once again. And here you see also, once again, we have a model where more or less every variable is numerical. The HDL cholesterol, that's the first one, that is our dependent variable, our outcome. It's numerical because that is really the milligram per deciliter. The alcohol consumption, that was gram alcohol per day, but pure alcohol per day. Then the BMI, that is really also numerical. It's not coded like obese, it's only numerical. The age, of course, also this is numerical. And the sex, we remember that was 0, 1. It was coded like 1 and 0. And here we see now the outcome. Oh, first of all, we should know how many persons there are in the observation, 109. 1,899. The adjusted R-square is 16%. Of course, only look at the adjusted R-square. Never look if you have more variables, and never look at the pure R-square. You can always see the adjusted R-square is smaller. That is by definition, because it is adjusted. It's getting always smaller than the pure R-square. Okay, it is not a good model. But you can see, wow, Here you have the p-value, that means the variable, which variables are significant. You can see all the variables are significant. Haha, we can directly interpret all variables as effective changing HDL cholesterol. Let us talk with alcohol consumption. What does the coefficient mean here? 1 gram alcohol consumption leads to an increase of HDL cholesterol of 0.13 milligram per deciliter. Very simple to explain. 1 BMI point. Whew, that's hard. 1 BMI point. Probably it was coded wrong. I have to check because that is really a very high value. That can't be. An increase in 1 BMI point would lead to a decrease in 484 milligram per deciliter in cholesterol. I haven't checked that, but I have to put check once again if BMI is coded correctly. Excuse me for that. Next week, that is a slide I have changed. Of course, I will check that. But of course, in this way, you have to interpret it. Age. 1 year of age increase will lead to a higher HDL of 0.05 milligram per deciliter. Sex. Of course, I always code one as female. Excuse me, but that's my rule. It is normally coded differently, therefore I always have to say. If you are female, because the other one is a reference group, if you are female, you have a 9.9 milligram per deciliter higher HDL cholesterol. And that's really well known that really females have a higher HDL cholesterol than males. Therefore, that's really fine.
But how do you know that males were the reference group? Did you choose?
Well, as it, my data set, one is always female.
Oh, okay.
But of course, normally you have something like a variable list where it is explained. Or in Stata, that's really, it's a very nice question. In Stata, you have also the possibility, and you will learn, I think, in the first lecture, how to label them.
Yeah.
And then you can label one is female, and two is male, or zero is male, it doesn't matter.
But zero, is it always the reference group that is?
The statistical, it's really difficult answer. It's a very difficult question. Because that depends to the statistical program. In Stata, normally they choose zero as reference.
It was
group.
Just because you said that the male was the reference group, but
exactly.
I was just wondering how did you know it?
Exactly. Of course, in Stata it is always zero, the reference group. And of course, as I code once, mostly one is female and zero is male, I know that it is like that. But otherwise you have really to look at the label and then you need to know what is the reference group, and in Stata the reference group is always zero. Unfortunately in SPSS it is mostly zero, but if zero is not there, it is the highest category that sometimes causes a lot of confusion. But therefore please always check what is used as reference group. That's really very important.
Stata was always zero.
Hmm? Stata is always zero, and then of course I think it is the lowest one, but I don't know exactly, but you have to check. And of course that is a very good point in Stata, because it is always, if you use E to explain, you will learn what does E mean now on Wednesday. If you use E, you get always in the output, of course not here because there's no E in, what is the reference group? And then you know it. And in SPSS, you need to know in beforehand. It's not written at any place, and that's really not the fine way. But therefore, that is the difference. But of course, I don't know exactly what is the reference group in Stata if zero is not there. If you quote, for example, 1, 2, 3, you have to define, I think one is coded as reference group in Stata, and in SPSS is the last one that I know. And SPSS is the last one.
The constant in the
Perfect,
is that
I forgot.
The intercept or was that?
Exactly, the constant is the intercept, and the constant is more or less that what you have at the beginning. That is really also, if you like to estimate your, if you like to estimate your y hat, you need to have the constant as well. You need to have the constant, that is this one, and you need to have each different simple beta coefficient. And really then to put it here, that means here to calculate your white hat, you need to put your constant here, that means 31.99 plus x1 would be alcohol consumption 0.13 multiplied by the gram of alcohol consumption minus 484.73 multiplied BMI plus, well, minus because it is negative, the beta, please understand it correctly. And here plus once again, H was the next one, 0.05, and so on and so on. In this way, you can estimate your weight hat. Okay, about model assumption, there's still a mistake in, because as I dropped week number one, now we will discuss that in the next week. If you change something, you don't change all the things you need to change. Therefore, please excuse me for that. That will happen probably several times, that there are some small mistakes in. Okay. Now we need to define problems about, when to apply what. Because you have different aims doing a linear regression. The first of all, and I think that is the most important aim in doing epidemiology research or medical research, you like to do the effect estimation. That means, in our case, let us look about here, our alcohol consumption. How big is the effect of alcohol consumption on HDL cholesterol? What can we change if we let all the person drink alcohol, 2 liters per day? Of course, and then of course you were interested particular in this estimate. And this is the estimate effect. Particular in psychology, you are more or less not interested that the score about stress is affecting 1.6 times getting, an outcome, because there you like to predict how probable it is to get the disease. And if you're really in a very low social class, you probably have a higher probability to get that psychiatric disorder or something like that. You're really not in the effect, but you like to predict something. That means you like to find out what kind of variables are explaining your outcome. And then you are really interested also in all these single variables, and that you like to explain exactly how big, how good your model explaining your outcome. That means you're really totally interested in the R-square. And here, of course, the R-square should be really very good, because that is the most important thing you are looking at. And you like only to explain how many predictors you need to predict your outcome or your depending variable. And there are something differences in. The most epidemiological part is only connected to the effect estimation. That means if you're talking about confounder, You always looking only in effect estimating, because the confounder is only important because it change the estimate. And then you are only interested in that if you like to know the estimates that make sense. And therefore, if you're talking about confounding, you're only talking about effect estimation. And I would say in statistics, 90% of all activities is connecting to effect estimation, and predicting variables or predicting models are not so often. Of course, they are also there, and therefore we need to explain them as well. But of course, the most important things are the effect estimation. And of course, what does it mean, confounding? Here, and of course, this question will be in the exam at least once. it's something that needs to be there. And of course, for the confounding, I always have three parts that need to be, because I believe all of you know what is confounding. But I think the most important thing is it should be associated with the exposure or the dependent variable. It should be associated with the outcome. That is the second part. And it should not be an intermediate step, and it should change the overall result. That are the most important ones. And then we are talking about confounder. And how to consider confounder in starter, I think that is explained in starter. We don't need to go through that carefully. But of course, that is also, I think that is really not important. I think that is more important really how to deal with the confounder in strata, because that is really a very simple analysis. First of all, let us talk our very simple problem here. Only up to here, that is our exposure, that is our outcome, and that is our confounder. How to deal with a confounding in starter. First of all, that is really important, you need to do a simple analysis, only up to here. That is the first step. Then you do a second step, and you do the analysis all together up to here. That means you have y that means the first step is without the confounder. You only have outcome and exposure, and here you have outcome, exposure and confounder. And then, and that is really the important part, you only look at these both beta coefficients. And you only have to look if these both beta coefficients have changed if you consider the confounder. Because if they are not changing, you can say the confounder is no confounder because it has not changed anything. Of course, if I have the model, for example, I like to estimate serum cholesterol or HDL cholesterol, and I like to see of, no, not BMI, is my exposure, and then I use the confounder, for example, the number of exams you ever had in your life as a confounder. I believe it won't change anything if I could, of course, you can probably expect it, that you have more exams in your life, probably you have drinking more, no, I don't know. Of course, there is no association, and therefore, that is not a confounder, and therefore, the beta won't change.
then you're not talking about a confounder. But yes?
When how will that be displayed on the output? Is it like you have the...
You have to calculate it by your own.
Yeah, but where do you look for the, what do you call it? The better?
We are coming to that later
okay.
on. Very good question, yes?
But the confounder shouldn't change the outcome, right? Oh, I don't know.
That you can't see. It is associated with the outcome, but you can't see it.
But the confounder would change the overall result.
Here is one example. I think that will explain in a better way. Of course, is there an explanation in before? Yes. That's later on, after interaction, but I think it makes sense to do it step by step. Here you have the main effect of lead levels in blood and the number of finger wrist taps per 10 seconds in a dominant hand. That's really a bit, it's about stress. How fast you can do that. Of course, don't try it because then I get nervous. Mm-hmm. But in this way, that was measured. And here they like to use the effect of lead because they believe if you have more lead in your blood, your brain is not working as, and then you can't do it as fast as it is, don't. If you don't have meat in your blood. That was a research question. And then they also like to think about confounder because they believe confounding of age is present because age, of course, as older you are, as less fast you get it. And of course, also the age, if you have more time to drink all this lead water content and all other lead sources, you can accumulate it. And therefore, if you are older, you probably always have more lead in, and therefore that might be a confounder because it is really considered or associated with both exposure and outcome. Okay, don't talk about interaction that we are doing later. And now we are looking for the results. First, we are doing the simple. Which one is the simple? That is the first one, exactly, because here you only have this lead concentration. Don't consider the 72, it doesn't matter now in that context. And the finger wrist traps, that is the max finger wrist tip, that means the maximum number they got in 10 seconds or something like that. And here you can see if the lead concentration is increasing in one unit, you're getting lesser and lesser. And here you see it is minus 0.22, that means you get less finger wrist taps if there is lead in. That is the final outcome, the simple analysis. And of course, you can also see it is significant. Then you're doing the multiple model, considering age. What is now? You can see the effect of lead is decreasing. That means that age is really a confounder because it changed the results that a lot of the effect of lead is caused because the person are older. Because when persons are older, they always accumulate more lead, and therefore you will overestimate the effect of lead if you don't adjust for age.
What if the number didn't get that adjusted? Look at it, it goes from 22 to 11. What if it only goes down to 21 when you adjust for age? Is it still a confounder then?
Perfect. Very nice question, because therefore we have the rule that is a rule of thumb, because that's all single scientists can discuss it. We say if the estimation change more than 10%, we are talking about confounding. Because that is a rule of the thumb. And therefore, of course, here you have more or less 50%, you see, from 22 to 11, that's really 50% decrease. Of course, you have to discuss about confounding. That is confounding. Therefore, here we have confounding, that's really very simple. And you see, you only look on the coefficient. You don't look on p-values. You don't start to discuss about p-values when you talk about confounding.
But the confounder could also be a positive value.
Perfect. Confounding can be also to decrease an effect.
Yeah.
It can also be that it happens once to me, then I was analyzing a really great question about H. pylori infection, Helicobacter pylori.
you know that, that's a bacterium in the stomach. And serum ferritin concentration, that is a marker of infectious diseases in the body. And then, of course, I did the analysis crude without adjusting, and I found that there was an increased infection marker when H. pylori was there. And then I thought, oh, that's perfect. That is that what I believe, because that's an infection. If H. pylori, that's a bacterium in the stomach, and then I get a higher infection marker. Perfect. I was glad. I like to publish it. But then I did confounders, and I adjusted for H. And then, of course, it was totally inverse. I could show that H. pylori infection was associated with a decrease in serum protein concentration, and that was significant. And only the adjustment or compounder really changed the overall result. But of course, it was published as well.
So in this example, would you then stratify H to see in which age groups it would be significant?
No, in this way, I'm only interested in the effect of blood lead. And I would say H is a compounder, and of course I can imagine that H is really a clear compounder because it accumulates over the age, the bleed, because if you have a longer time to live, of course you will have more blood, more lead in your blood. That's really a kind, and therefore I would only say I always have to present this one, not interested in anymore. Of course sometimes else, but then we can go further, because that was you was asking now, is about, no, we have to go to interaction as well. That is now the interaction. Because then you have to go further into a separate analysis. You have later on, but there we will also do some epidemiology method that we will discuss, for example, in the DRG. Directed acyclic graphs that really likes to check if your confounder is a confounder and if your confounder need to be adjusted for in the model. Because then really sometimes if you start, particularly if you're interested in myocardial infarction, you have confounders and must. There are really a lot, age, sex, you always have. But then you have alcohol consumption, physical activity, history of diabetes, hypertension, and so on, and you will get really a huge amount of variables. That's not possible. And then you can use that one to diminish the necessary set that you need to adjust for. Therefore, there is a lot possible to do, but at the moment, that's only, we are checking ancient sex. But later on, you can recognize there will come a lot more. But let us start with something simple and go on further, step by step. Okay, but now interaction, yes?
Could you please explain the difference between interaction and confounder?
Yes. That's now, let us talk about interaction first. First explain interaction, what it is. If you have lung cancer and asbestos, I think that's the best example. I don't know exactly the numbers, but I don't believe that is really truth, but what I'm saying is only nearly truth. What do you believe, lung cancer and smoking? What is the odds ratio for lung cancer and smoking? That's a relative risk. The odds ratio is a bit higher, it's 9. But it's totally perfect, that's good. What is the odds ratio for asbestos, if you work during your work period with asbestos and to get lung cancer?
We just said it's probably higher.
Yeah. No, I don't know exactly, but I believe it is something like 9 as well. But now it is difficult, because if you have, that means here you smoke, and here you have asbestos,
But what happens if you smoke and are associated with asbestos?
Isn't this synergistic?
It's a multiplicative interaction. That means the odds ratio then is 9 multiplied by 9. It's 81. That's really, of course, it, not the, the value itself, but it's really very, very high if you have both. And that is an interaction, because if you smoke, well, if you do nothing, but not smoking and not asbestos, you have, of course, no, an odds ratio that is 1. If you smoke only alone without being associated with asbestos, then you have an odds ratio of 9. If you only have asbestos exposure in your work, then you have an odds ratio of 9. But unfortunately, if you have both, then you really die directly after work. And that means interaction. Interaction means, therefore, and therefore it is really, I think it is the most intense interaction I have ever heard. Therefore, I think that example is really nice. But of course, it means really the effect is different in different groups. And of course, that makes it also important, because you, a person would also say, okay, smoking is a confounder. That could you say, because it always overestimates the overall effect if you, or it's underestimate the overall effect if you're not considering confounder as smoking. But of course, it would be more correct to say it is interaction. Because particularly if both are present, then of course the persons die directly. And that means also, if you like to do a health prevention activity, well, which group would you choose? Of course, I would always choose that one that is most risky, but of course you can say also, you can't do anything against smoking, therefore you can do only an asbestos. I don't know. That's, should every person know by itself or decide by itself, but it is important to know which is the most risky group. And therefore, if you have an interaction, then you need to do a stratified analysis, because otherwise you can't see if that here is 81 and the other one is 9. Because if you do everything in the small model as we did it before, we will probably see an odds ratio of, I don't know, 80. And don't think, asbestos is, has an odds ratio of 18, even though that's not right, because that is mostly explained by smoking. And therefore, then you need to do a stratified analysis that you have one odds ratio only for persons only exposed to asbestos and one for persons only exposed to smoke, and then you find this one. Okay. Also, one example, because here we have another model, it's the same finger, wrist, traps, tips, wrist, you know how it's called, the same model, but here we are talking about also once again the leak level effect, but here we are talking about an interactive effect of sex, that probably males are faster, slower than females. Of course, I really have to say, that is really fine, because here you see in this program step XE is used. See you that? In the program step you see XE, please always do it if you like to, if you have categorical variables. And here you see that before the sex you have this E. And if you put this E in, you get this first line, and that's really the very nice line, because it explains to you that sex has two codes, 1 and 2, and of course you need to know what is what. As I have not coded that, that was Pia, I think the one is male, because normally it's done like that. And then naturally coded is 6, 1 is omitted. That means the males in this way would be the reference group. Okay, and then of course you get also something like the so-called interaction term. An interaction term that is so simple, you should only believe that you multiply the variables. You only need to think, asbestos and smoking, the odds ratio is a multiplicative risk. Therefore, I need to multiply the variables. And that is really the program step in Stata. You need to multiply the both variables you believe they should interact. And that means you need, in the program step, only to put a star in between the two variables of interest. And then you get the interaction term. And that is the interaction term. That's really a bit crazy, but you can see that here you get the first, the sex, as one part of the variable. And then, of course, the second part is the blood lead level. That means here you're looking for the interaction between sex and blood lead level. Sounds crazy, sounds complex, sounds difficult. It is totally simple because from the step in the starter, you only need to look for that line because that explains the interaction. And in this way, because confounding, please never consider p-values, interaction, only consider p-values. That's very simple. And then you need to look at this interaction term. Is it significant? No, perfect. That means you don't have any interaction. That means you check for interaction only to put this interaction term in. And if it's significant, what you need to do then, that then you need to follow that rule that the person here before on the first line said, do a stratified analysis, look at different stratas of males and females and look how it's working in males and females, because then you have an interaction. If not, drop that variable again and you have checked for interaction and there is no interaction. But then you can drop that variable as well. Yes.
So the reason that we only have to look at the third line is because that's the interaction between the variables.
Exactly.
Okay.
Of course, please don't start to interpret this because it is possible to interpret, but that would take months to explain it to you. And of course, it is not necessary because if you have the rule, if there is an interaction, then do a stratified analysis, then you're on the sure side, and then you do everything correct. Of course, if you talk a very advanced biostatistic person, he will say, you don't need to do a stratified analysis. You can calculate all what you want with this. Yes, you can. But of course, we should also keep, it should not be too complex. Therefore, I think the best rule is don't start to interpret this. Do a stratified analysis, then it's everything okay. There was one question,
yeah, I guess. Still not clear. How you know if it's a confounding variable or interacting variable? How you consider a variable?
The interaction you consider with this term. And now if you look, for example, that means you have to decide before. Now I'm looking for confounding. And if you're looking for confounding, you do this both steps. And then you can say, okay, H is confounder. Then you're doing the second step. Now I'm looking for interaction. And then you're doing this, and that is the third step. If you don't know which variable is confounder and which variable is interaction, and you like to check for all, you're working 6 weeks. That is the role in statistics. Every person believes statistics is easy done, we do it fast, and then of course everything knows, and that is the final model. It is hard work. And therefore, you need to define, when you do your research question, you need to define, that are my confounders, and I check for them. That are my interaction, and I will check for them. And of course, I would never suggest, please check for 200 confounders and 20 interactions, because that is too much. Keep one or two interactions, that's totally fine because most of the persons forget it totally. And the confounder that depends on the research question. If you talk about cardiovascular disease, you have to consider a lot. But if you talk about something else, brain tumor, you don't have to consider a lot. And why should you think about it?
But you can have both. You can both have a confounder and an inductor.
Exactly.
Okay.
And you have always to check for both.
Okay.
And there are two different procedures. You can't do one analysis and then you can collect that is confounder, that is no. You have to check for each single step. But a very good question. Thanks for that. Okay. The next break. Oh yes, of course, that's just in time. And then we are talking in the last part about prediction. 5 minutes, is that okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If that is changing from the simple to the adjusted body is important, nothing else. Sometimes it happens that considering the confounder, the effect disappears. That means the overall effect is not significant anymore. And then, of course, it doesn't matter. It is confounding, and therefore you need to interpret it like it is not significant anymore. And therefore, please never think about p-values when thinking about confounder. Vice versa, interaction, you always need to consider significance of the interaction. And that is now also the tricky thing. If you look at interaction, and you have this term in, and you find out it is significant, unfortunately, I have to say, don't start to interpret any other of these variables connected to the interaction term, because that you can't anymore. And therefore, if it is significant, the next step you need to do is to do a stratified analysis. Do everybody know what is a stratified analysis? Because that means you do it, in our case, it was interaction of sex, and stratified analysis means then I'm doing one analysis only for males and one analysis only for females. That means I separate in the both groups where I believe the interaction takes place. In our place here, of course, if I'm interested in asbestos, the effect of asbestos, then I would do a stratified analysis for smokers, where I can find the overall risk for asbestos is 9. No, it's 81. And then I will do an analysis for not smokers, and then I will find that the odds ratio for having asbestos or being exposed to asbestos is 9. And that means always the interaction variable needs to be stratified. Of course, you can never stratify through exposure or your outcome. That you can't do. You can only do the additional variable. Okay. The next step. Of course, that is really, I believe the weather here in Denmark is better as we expected, because that is the first time while doing the lectures that it fits, that it is really raining today. Normally it's not raining today, but today it is really raining and we can look at the forecast for the weekend. Hopefully it will be nice weather, but I don't know. And that is a kind of prediction we are talking about. That means we like to give an estimation of that what happens in the, it's often used for what happens in the future, or it is also in a lot of risk assessment, probably you know that as well. If I have a BMI of that, if I'm a smoker, if I'm in that age category, and then I have hypertension, and then my risk in getting that and that is 20%. That is also used a kind of prediction, because you put all your predictive situation in and then it's predicting how probable it is that you get myocardial infarction, diabetes mellitus or something like that. Therefore it is used a lot and therefore we should discuss it as well. For example, also in the political view, if you for example need to plan nursing homes, probably would say, why we should plan that? They are there, and of course not. Because our age distribution will increase and change, of course, over time, and we need to be prepared that later on we will have more elderly in the when they use their homes, and therefore we need to plan that. We need to know that, and we need to predict that, and that is prediction. Sometimes it is also necessary to get some information about some blood samples. They are really expensive to get, and then of course you can also predict it
from some given others information, for example. Therefore, there are a lot of rules available, points available, where you really need such predictive models. And of course, as I said before, the R-square is really important in that context. And of course, it is also important because your predictive should be good. That means you should trust in that beta you get here, because you like to predict with this beta something that is really afterwards used. And that is really best if the beta is good. And the beta is good if the p-value is really highly significant, and the p-value is estimated by the standard error. Because to estimate this p-value, you need the standard error. And to estimate the confidence interval, you need the standard error. And therefore, the most better way is that the standard error should be small, because then you get a very small confidence interval and a very high significant p-value. And therefore, it is easier to say the standard error should be small. And of course, there is also, it should be simple, but it should not lose all the information. Therefore, you need to use the best model that is available. And how to get that, that's really tricky. You don't know it, but there are some statistical methods to measure.
Yes, what to do
explains best variable. And that's really the fine thing. Okay, but of course that you should also consider if you do an analysis, and there's also, I think I love this, giving the rule of thumbs, and I really have to say they are not my, I think that was the person who has done the statistical teaching before, that was Pia Feld-Larsen, she is now working in Odense, unfortunately, and 20 observations, if you like to do a multiple model, I would say, that's difficult. Of course you can, but of at least one variable. Because you have your outcome, that's not counting, but as dependent variable you have your exposure and one confounder. And therewith you have two variables in the model. And with 20 observations, you can't have more. Okay. Before talking about that, I like to talk about the R-square, because the R-square, as I explained, is the explained variance, and therefore you can see out of the R-square something about the quality of the model, but also about the distribution. Only to show that, I have that example here, and that shows really, if you have, what do you believe? Is that a good model or is that a bad model? That's a good model, exactly. If you calculate the R-square, that's German and Danish with this comma in between, of course here should only be a point, not a comma. It is really a very high R-square. And that you can see, because the R-square is always depending on the residuals. Do you remember what residuals is? Residuals is the distance between the points and the line. And therefore, here you have very small distances between points and line, and therefore it is a very good model and you have a very high R-square. What happens if you have one outlier? You think about this red point, because that red point is really one point that is lying outside of all others. What happens to the regression line if we add this one observation in the regression line? All the others are the same, but this one observation is added. The regression will totally change, because this outlier really changed totally the overall distance. Yes? Very good question. At first of all, you see the R-square, you add one point and the R-square diminishes from 0.89 to 0.66. What should we do? Of course, really, you can ask 7 statisticians and probably you will get 8 answers. Of course, the normal statistician likes to say you should. It's better to have a good model as to consider the outlier. And therefore, normally, outliers are excluded. Exactly. That is the easiest way to deal with outlier. Of course, then you get sometimes a problem. Of course, in this way, as you could see, it's really an outlier. And probably you believe also later on it is a typing mistake or something like that. It's something really crazy that allows you even better. If you find a person with a BMI of 64, I would probably say it's an outlier, because 64, can you have a BMI of 64? I don't know if that is possible. In this way, you can really decide sometimes. But of course, if you have, for example, 20 outliers, then it's difficult.
Yeah, I was about to ask that. If you have an observation of 12 and you have 4 outliers,
then you can't.
Validity, yeah.
Exactly. Then you can't, if, of course, because then you would say 20% outliers, that's not an outlier anymore. That is really a bad distribution. Because outliers should be less than 1%.
Okay.
Of course, then this can't be an outlier because it's more than 1%, but it should be really only a very small amount of data. And therefore, but of course, there are really different rules to deal with that, and therefore that depends also to the kind of, if you work with blood measurements, in general, there are some rules in general always to lead the lowest 2.5% and the highest 2.5%, because they are sometimes measurement errors. And of course, it is also sometimes only to consider that outlier should be excluded, because serum cholesterol concentration of 1,667 milligram per deciliter would mean that you will only have cholesterol in your blood, nothing else. That might be, it must be wrong, and therefore it should be excluded. But this is really depending to each single question you have. But best is, from the statistical point of view, to exclude, and of course also to decide the minimum amount of data to exclude, only that one that really makes sense to exclude. Okay, what else can lead to worse prediction? Of course, now we have a totally different distribution here. And if we would do a regression analysis, we would say, is that good? Of course, compared to that one, it's bad. But of course, yes, you can see something like that. You only need to define these both as outliers, and then it's working fine. Therefore, take care of defining outliers. That's really also a bit difficult. Sometimes you decide to define outliers because you like to see something. Mm-hmm. But what is reality here? Because here, if you do the correlation code, the R-square, you will see 10%. That is not really good. But if you believe there is something like a spline regression, that means it's not a linear, it's a log linear association, you will probably, if you do that, of course, that we won't do here in our course because that is applied biostatistics, but of course you could do it. And therefore, if you really try to consider that kind of association, you would probably have very good R-square. But as you, at the moment, only can look for linear association, you have a bad R-square. But you're not explaining the data like they are. And then you could easily understand the problem of outliers, because probably as you like to delete 4 points in 12, you probably can have the idea, okay, I delete these 2 and then it's perfect. But of course, that also causes problems, and therefore take care in deleting outliers. Okay, now we should go back to where we stopped.
Yes, about that pollution and mortality. I have to check the time. Yes, don't have time. Here we are talking about age-adjusted mortality rates, death per million. Overall, it is only it's a so-called ecological study that you really look on different areas and look how their different characteristics are, and then really to look the mortality rates in the different areas, and then you try to connect this pollution of sulfur dioxide pollution, nitrous oxide pollution, general temperature, because you believe as colder the temperature per winter time, as more mortality you will have, or vice versa, I don't know. You like to predict the mortality rate in that specific regions. And of course something like that is always done in the United States, and therefore you always have something like, how many states you have in the United States? How many?
52.
52?
52.
Why there are 59? It's also together with Alaska? Yes, of course, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know. Then they probably put some Canadian, some region from Canada as well in there. I don't know exactly how they are getting 59. But normally in such examples, you can always see this 50 or on 89 states. That depends on what they are counting as single states. Okay, but here you see now they try to explain or predict the mortality given by the overall, what is HC pollution? Now I have to check once again, excuse me for that. That's the overall air pollution, the nitric oxide pollution, sulfur dioxide pollution, the general temperature, and of course they believe also not only the general temperature, that means the temperature in the winter time, but also the Julie temperature, that means the temperature in the summertime, explain something about mortality, the relative humidity, how many rainfall down per month in overall in the year, of course then also some population density explanations, the number of long whites, of course we're talking about that in the United States, they are always interested in that. Population of housing, that means housing, the income is also considered, and therefore you have a huge amount of variables to predict mortality. And if you look here, you can see very soon. Relative humidity. Did you believe that humidity has to do with mortality? Non-wide, of course, that is clear. Nothing else? Okay. But now, think about the rule of thumb. How many variables should you have? With 90, let us talk about 60. It's easier to calculate. 60 observations.
Six.
How many do we have?
Too many.
Too many. How would you deal now with that? To drop?
Well, what could we drop? Oh, we can drop all this with temperature because I believe that's has nothing to do with it. Or we could also drop all the source population density, non-whites, housing. We don't interested in that. Of course, we could do it by this, and you easily recognize it doesn't make sense. What can we do else? Yes?
Make more than one model?
Yes, but if we stratify, we would lose the number. That means if we have, for example, if we could stratify, for example, countries with a general temperature above 10 and below 10, then we have two different regions. But then, of course, in one we get 30 and in the other one we get 29. And then, of course, we can only have three per each single model. It's a good idea, but it's not working, unfortunately not. Because if you stratify, you lose power. And then because you have less numbers in the stratified tables. Because overall you have 60, but if you stratify you have 30 and 30. And therefore that is unfortunately not the case. We need to drop variables. What kind of variables would you like to drop? The most significant? Least significant, of course. That is the way. And in this way, of course, that is really also one procedure that is done in Stata. Of course, now we are going further after that. And that is called stepwise regression. And in the so-called stepwise regression, we like to diminish the amount of variables ruled out by statistical procedures. And of course, we, as you remember the picture, we have a lot of variables. We can't put all of them. But of course, the significance we like to have, but we don't know exactly whom to delete. And then, of course, the least significant probably are the less important. And in this way, we can do it. And there are a lot of ways possible to do it. Because one way is the so-called backward elimination, and you probably should only keep on that because that is the simplest one. That means we are starting with the overall model, and the first step you can do by your own because you can check what is the least significant. Ah, this one. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, relative humidity is dropped in the first step. Then they are doing the analysis once again, looking at the next least significant, the next variable is dropped. And then they do it third time, looking at the least significant, and then this variable is dropped. And then, of course, the computer is crazy, because they are doing it, up to which point? Up to the point where you say, now you have to stop. And that is really, wait a moment. Here you see the stepwise regression. You need to name the probability when they don't need to drop the variable anymore. And that is normally, I don't know why, it is not 0.05. Because you should have at least one or two not significant variables in the model, and therefore they choose a p-value of 0.10. And of course, in this way, if you look here, you do not have more variables below 0.1 because they are all dropped, and you only have now these variables in with lower p-value than 0.01. And of course now you can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's still one too much, but of course we are not talking about that anymore. We keep like it is, but the rule of the thumb is the rule of the thumb. It's not really the rule that you always need to consider. Of course you should consider here you still have one variable.
So
yes.
You actually do make a statistic analysis with all the probable variables, and then you take them the ones who are least significant out.
Exactly.
Okay.
That means you could do it by your own. If you really start to do regression all variables, then check the least significant, put it out to the next regression. But of course, that is not necessary because that is really a very simple program step in Stata that you use stepwise. And then you put the limit that you only write stepwise in before. And then you put the limit from until when variables should be dropped. And that is might be 0.1, that means 10%. And then you put the normal regression you are using for it behind. And here the example is done in linear regression because you see the normal regressions come and regress. You can also use a logistic regression or you can use a Cox regression. A stepwise is only a prefix on your common line, but you can use the prefix for any other regression model you like to use. But it is mostly only used in linear regression because linear regression is the best, has the most power to estimate something, and therefore it is mostly used in that area. Okay. That's perfect. I'm ready. Of course, probably I forget to explain something and that I can repeat, because here it is now presented the backward selection. And if you hear something like backward selection, you probably imagine there is something else available as well. It is also possible to do a forward selection. That means that's the same vice versa. You are starting with one. If it is significant, yes, you put the next one and so on until you have everything. That means it is only vice versa, but the backward selection is the most used. And there is also one, but that is really very tricky to explain. It's working with back and forward at the same time. It starts with a full model and then also add something again if you believe it is significant once again. Therefore, that's really, there are tricky versions available, but the backward selection is that is most used. And therefore, I think that's enough to know the backward selection. But you need to explain it always because there are others as well. Okay, here you find the groups. I don't know if you have access to them. They won't on the, and of course these are the groups in the mornings, and the other two groups are in the evening, in the afternoon. And I hope everything is right like it is, because Janne sent also around your wishes, if you like to add your wishes. If something needs to change, I like to suggest really to talk to persons. If you like to change from group 4 in the morning group, then you need to find the person in the morning group to which you can switch. In this way, I think that's no problem, but otherwise, please don't decide, oh, now I'm that group, and I don't like the notes from the instructor, I need to change, please don't do that. That's really not fine.
Will it be the same instructors as in the bridging course, or
no, unfortunately
new?
Not.
Okay.
They are new ones, but I believe they are really good.
Okay.
That's really, yes. There are 4 instructors or 3 instructors at the moment.